Let's talk about the Boston Bruins. Charlie McAvoy also skating, but before practice a little bit earlier today, missed the last couple of games, including the big one, the Winter Classic out in South Bend a couple of days ago with that lower body injury. Now, according to head coach Bruce Cassidy, McAvoy said he felt good and could be a full participant at practice tomorrow. He will not play, however, in the Bruins game tomorrow night. This is a Bruins team that, of course, is starting to get healthy, although McAvoy has been in and out of the lineup at times this year. When he's in, Butchie, what does he do for this team?
Well, he's a great young player. I mean, first and foremost, he can skate, so he's a puck transporter. He can get that puck out in a real hurry. He's very good on the offensive side. We've watched him on breakaway scenarios. We've watched him in shootouts, so he's a good playmaker just all over. So his overall game is very, very good. But I will say they will be very, very careful with him because you mentioned it. He's been in and out of the lineup, and they haven't missed him nearly as much as you might miss Eichel because they're in a playoff position, and they've been able to win games with a very injury-prone team this year. So, yes, McAvoy, when he's in and he's partnered up with Chara in particular, they're really good together.
At this point, don't you think Boston's thinking, can we just get everyone healthy? Right? Like, just give us 10 games. Like, just stop taking such – and we're not talking – fourth line or seventh defenseman getting knocked out solely. It's been their first line, first pair of players for weeks on end, and they are getting healthier, and Chara's coming back, and Bergeron's and Brown, but they want to get their whole roster together. DeBrusque, he's been in and out. He's a pretty important player, but they want everyone together to get the last 35 games of the season and some momentum and some continuity heading into the playoffs, because I still think they envision themselves to be Stanley Cup contenders.
Yeah, I think so. And the way they played, especially when they had all those guys out, like they had four or five of their regular defensemen in their top six. They weren't playing. They were still winning hockey games. And, of course, as you mentioned, Bergeron is on the lineup. The only good thing about all of that is that they won't be too tired because they've had plenty of rest, not only physically, but certainly mentally. But now you've got to be on a decent enough roll. Mm-hmm. And the only way to get on a roll is to get healthy. And so the Boston Bruins, I'm sure, are thinking, oh, second half, let's have all the horses running at the same time.
We welcome in Preds reporter Lindsay Raley on FaceTime. Lindsay, big news for Nashville today. Philip Forsberg expected to return to the lineup tonight after missing the last 17 games. What does he bring to this lineup, and how did the line shake out, do you think?
Well, Jameson, you were just talking about Boston and their injuries. The Preds are no stranger to that. And as you said, Philip Forsberg on the ice this morning in morning skate. He's officially off IR, so he is expected to be in the lineup here tonight. Philip was leading the team in goals, even having after missed 17 games until last game in Montreal, of course, when Craig Smith tied him up at 14 goals. But I've spoken with Philip throughout this injury, and he has just been so disappointed to be out. He's one of the biggest competitors in the team, so of course, not happy to be out. The only silver lining being that it's happening now and not in March or April or something like that. There you see the Preds' projected lines for morning skate being down on the fourth line with Goudreau and Grimaldi, who have both been playing incredible for the Nashville Predators. But we all know Coach Laviolette is no stranger to switching up the lines in the middle of a game. So who knows? Maybe we'll get that Jofa line back together at some point, but we'll see.
All right, and I see the professional bag chucker himself, Chris Mason, kind of interrupting a flawless concentration by you. So please tell Mason, Willie over your other shoulder, we said hi. Heck, those guys, if they want to participate, we can have a little round table here.
Jump in.
Exactly. I'll go to you on this one, though. The Preds facing off against one of the best teams tonight over in the East in Toronto. What do you think we should expect for this matchup?
Oh, man, I think this one's going to be a drag out. We are going to have a tight game. This one's been marked on the schedule, especially having this long road trip. It's going to be big. I mean, you've got the number two offense in the league being Toronto going against the number one defense in the league. Toronto averaging 3.71 goals per game. And then, of course, the Predators only averaging 2.51 goals against. So this should be a really big one. You know, the Preds defense has been stepping up. They've been able to create more offense. That was an issue, had a little bit of a lull, but they have been stepping up. And you know, also a big tilt tonight, I think it's going to be goaltending. Pekka Rinne expected to be starting. He's been huge. And then, of course, Michael Hutchinson coming off of that shutout. So goaltending, as always, but especially tonight, it's going to be a big factor.
All right, the Preds starting off that road trip on a sour note in Detroit. How are they able to kind of turn things around and right the ship?
Well, Jameson, there was no sugarcoating it after that game. I don't know if you got to see any of the scrums, but Coach Laviolette and the players clearly not happy with the way that they played in Detroit, but bounced back in Montreal, and that's the kind of response that you want. I spoke with Coach Laviolette this morning, and he said that he feels that was probably one of the best full 60 minutes he's ever seen out of his team. And you know, that's exactly what they wanted to see. The only goal that Montreal got was from former Predator Shea Weber. And 18 seconds later, Craig Smith picks up his second goal. Remember speaking with Coach McCarthy after that period, and he said, hey, that's the exact response we want to see after a team tallies a goal. So certainly the bounce back game that they needed. Speaking with Mattias Ekholm after the game, who tallied a goal and an assist, he said the same thing. He said, hey, that's what makes our team strong, is every time we are challenged by our coaching staff, by ourselves, we seem to step up. So mark of a good team, good for them to be able to bounce back after a Detroit game on the back end of a tough back-to-back.
All right, and leading up to that Detroit game, as we mentioned, a bit of a tough patch for this Nashville team. Who or how many people stepped up to really get this squad back on track?
I think a lot of it has been the Preds' defense. You know, that's always been their staple between goaltending, and then you've got guys like our staples as far as Roman Josi, the captain, and Mattias Ekholm. Roman has been playing incredible on both ends of the ice. You know, he's second on the team in points with 40, and then Mattias Ekholm leading the team in plus-minus. He's one of those leaders, both of them, who have been able to step up. And you know, you just speak about our goaltending in general. Juuse Saros has been great. He was awesome in Montreal. Before that, he got a shutout against Philadelphia. Pekka has always been the backbone of this team, but Juuse Saros has definitely stepped up for the team as well. So right now, I think the difference maker really is in the defense. Now, that being said, Philip Forsberg, as we mentioned, comes back in the lineup tonight. You said how well Toronto's power play has been playing. Nashville's power play has struggled a little bit, but Philip Forsberg back in the lineup, that could be a big difference maker. Something else to keep an eye on tonight.
All right, we're looking forward to that one. Speaking of keeping our eye on things, tell Mays to keep his eye off of Twitter right now. And tell him to get
I will.
Start prepping
I'll
for the game,
Mays.
All right? Lindsay, appreciate it. Enjoy
good.
The game tonight. Philip Forsberg, the captain, joining your fourth line. That's
how long does he stay on the fourth
line? Mike, yeah, maybe one shift that he'll be on the fourth line, and then that would be maximum.
Why put him there as
well,
a coach?
Well, you know, obviously they had a very good game last game against the Montreal Canadiens. So as a former coach, you know, you don't like to change too much. But in this case, I expect Peter to move up Forsberg in a hurry. I mean, this is an elite forward. He is the best forward that Nashville has, and he plays in all situations. He's really good in the corners, very strong. He plays with some bite, and he's got all kinds of skill. Where he can pass it, he can shoot it. I mean, he's just a tremendous player. So he's going to play as many minutes as the coach thinks he can get out of him. So don't be thinking he's playing 10 or 12 minutes. If he's ready to go, it's going to be 18 to 20.
As good as Nashville is, when you think of their forwards, he's probably their only game breaker. Their individual guy who can kind of take on other defenders, make one-on-one plays happen and score goals like right. that. Well, Johansson's a very good player. He's more of a setup guy. Arvidsson's an energy guy. But when Forsberg's there, he's a guy who can just create offense. You see the stats bear it out, how much better they are with him in the lineup than without. Now, this board is a little bit misleading because some of those games where he did not play, neither did Victor Arvidsson, neither did P.K. Subban. So you're taking out three very important players. But I think for Forsberg, he's just so unique on a really good Nashville team that he can't be replaced, and they had trouble doing it. But now, thankfully for Nashville, Victor Arvidsson, he's back. P.K. Subban, he's back. Philip Forsberg, he's back. Guys are getting closer to being 100% healthy. Kyle Turris is still not quite there yet, but you see what a difference these guys have made just in the last few games in balancing their lineup, getting guys in the right spots. And we also saw in that graphic previously, their power play is under 15%. Yeah. Forsberg and Arvidsson and Subban in the lineup will change that in a hurry.
Absolutely. I mean, they have the ability to score those big goals. And as you mentioned, I mean, when you have to play without certain guys, then the domino effects.
Yep.
Then guys play. You have second liners playing on your first line. You have seventh defenseman playing in the sixth, and everybody gets out of whack, and they're just not quite as efficient. And then you start trying to do a little bit too much. And then when you get going down the tank a little bit, well, we know how that all runs.
Stu Cowan of the Montreal Gazette joining us now on ArenaCam. Stu, the Habs announcing earlier today that Carey Price will not participate in the All-Star game coming up out in San Jose. What's your initial reaction to this decision?
A brilliant decision, a really good decision. I mean, the Canadians are going to go as far as Carey Price can carry them. And, you know, he's had a minor lower body injury that he said he's been playing with for 7 weeks. He missed the final three games of 2018 to sort of let it heal a bit. He came back the last game, but you know, they need him going forward. And you know, if he was to get hurt in the All-Star game, their playoff hopes are gone. So it makes sense. I mean, he'll have to sit out a game like Alex Ovechkin, the same deal. But it's a smart move by the Canadiens. Carey Price has to carry this team on his back, and the rest will do him good. And hopefully for him and the Canadiens, it'll, whatever that lower body irritation is what Mark Bergevin called it tonight. Hopefully that'll heal over that period.
You mentioned that nagging injury. Bigger picture, especially if they want Price healthy for the rest of the season, is that cause for concern, or is this just a precautionary measure?
Well, it's always cause for concern. I mean, Carey's had a history, you know, history of injury the last few years. You know, last season he had chronic fatigue. He's had four lower body injuries since November 2017. It seems to be something that comes back a lot. Yeah, so I mean, it's something they're going to, you know, it's the first year of an eight-year contract. So it's something they're going to have to really take care of and keep an eye on going forward. And missing the All-Star game is one of those ways they can do that. So, you know, especially since Anthony Niemi's really struggled this season. You know, his last time he had a strong game, but, you know, the last time Minnesota, they played in Minnesota, he let in seven goals on 23 shots, and Carey Price was supposed to be a night off for him. He had to come on in relief in the third period. So, again, Carey Price's health, you know, I asked Mark Bergevin during his news conference earlier tonight what's his biggest concern moving forward for the second half of the season, and he said injuries, and at the top of that list has to be Carey Price.
All right, let's go back to their last game against Nashville. P.K. Subban once again returning to face his former team at the Bell Center on Saturday. What's impressed you the most about the milestone performance that P.K. put on?
Well, you know, with P.K., he comes back, he's such a lightning rod in this city. He's one of those players in Montreal and elsewhere. It seems like people either love him or hate him. You know, I wrote a column about the trade saying it looks like Nashville has still won the trade. The amount of response you get from it, a lot more negative than positive, but people in Montreal, for whatever reasons, don't, you know, there seems to be more people don't like PK than do, or at least they're more vocal than the other ones. But you know, for PK, the thing I've always admired about PK Subban, the bigger the game, the better he plays. Whatever off-ice stuff he has going on with his production companies or whatever else, it never affects his game. He always shows up to play. He's a big personality. He was a big personality in the room here in Montreal. It seemed to become a problem, at least it was perceived to be a problem by Marc Bergevin and the coaching staff at the time, and that's one of the big reasons he was shipped out. But then, you know, last season when the Canadiens had the disaster, Marc Bergevin said the biggest problem was a bad attitude in the room. So maybe PK wasn't the biggest problem in the room at the time. But, you know, he came back here, and it was a short trip. They played the night before in Detroit. They flew in here, arrived early in the early morning hours Saturday morning, played, and then left right after the game to go to Toronto. But every time PK comes back to Montreal, it's a special, special time.
All right, you mentioned the trade. Let's talk about the other part of that blockbuster trade. Shea Weber missed a chunk of this season with the injury, recovering from that. How has he made an impact on the ice since returning?
He's had a huge impact. I mean, he's been playing over 25 minutes a game, which is quite remarkable. And you think he's a 33-year-old guy who didn't play in almost a calendar year. He had this, you know, he played 26 games last season after breaking his foot in the first game. It resulted in tendon damage in his left foot, which required surgery. And then he had the offseason knee surgery on his right knee. So to come back after missing almost a full year and just pick up right where he left off, if not even better, I think he has been better because he's actually 100% healthy. And he's just his leadership role. I mean, he's always been a leader, but the fact he actually now has the C on his sweater also makes him even have more of an impact as a leader. And, you know, I mentioned Carey Price. They're going to go as far as Carey Price will carry them. Carey Price and Shea Weber are the two key players on this team. And excuse me, he's played really, really well since he's come back and just logged a ton of ice time. And, you know, you see why Mike Babcock called him the Man Mountain when he had him with Team Canada.
He certainly is. He's the brawny man, just not paper towels, the ice hockey version. Stu, thank you very much. Should be a good one tonight at Bell Center. Game 41 of the regular season for Minnesota, so the halfway point. Mm-hmm. Also the halfway point of the 13-year deals for Zach Parise and Ryan Suter. And when those deals are up, both players will be 40. Let's assess at the halfway poll right now. Mm-hmm. How has the signings gone? How would you grade them?
It's a great time to kind of look back at these two guys came in, signed the exact same deal on the same day. They're a big package deal that we're supposed to revamp, reshape, and lead the Minnesota Wild to the promised land, which would be a Stanley Cup. Now, they've done kind of what they're supposed to do. They've gone in, they've reshaped that team. They have been their identity, and they have been their personality. They've led them to great regular season success, but they haven't quite been able to get them over the hump in the playoffs. They've probably been considered an underachieving team in the playoffs for the amount of times they've gotten there and for as good as they've been in the regular season. So I guess it's mixed reviews. Both guys are having fantastic years once again this year. No signs of slowing down just yet. Zach Parise bouncing back from his injury-plagued seasons to be very good, almost a point a game and 40-goal pace. But big picture, I don't know if you can consider it a success if through the first 6.5 years, which would be the best time they're going to play, the prime, they're not going to get much better toward their late 30s, they haven't quite gotten as far in the playoffs as they wanted to.
No, and I think that's the key word. They just haven't got it done in the playoffs, and perhaps they haven't surrounded them with enough other good players, because one good forward and one good defense.
Can't afford them, Butchie. Yeah. They took all the money.
Well, that's the problem then. So, for me, if you were going to sign two guys you thought was going to take you to the next step, it didn't happen. It made them a very competitive team, and that's the way they play. They could play a very competitive game, but to get them up to what I would call an elite team, no, it didn't happen. So for me, no, it wasn't a good signing. I mean, yes, nothing against those guys. They're good players. But no, if you were trying to get them to an elite level, that didn't happen with this team.
Last 10 games, 4-5-1, 500 hockey there, and 500 hockey over much of the season. I asked Mike Rupp the other night, what do you make of Minnesota Wild? I can't really put my finger on what this team is. And you said the same thing a couple hours ago at our pre-production meeting. So I'll ask you. Oh. The Minnesota Wild, what are they? What is this team's identity this year?
Seems to be the answer should be I can't quite put my finger on it.
Yeah.
You know what? I think they are kind of who they have been, which is a good team. Not one of the best teams, but kind of a 8 to 14 team in the league. Now, they're a little bit lower than that, I think, because Devan Dubnyk's had some off moments this year as opposed to his usual high standard. They've had some injuries to deal with. Some of their young players maybe haven't been quite as good as they were hoping. But they're still on pace for, 90-something points, and they'll probably got to make the playoffs again, and Bruce Boudreau still does a really good job. But they're just, they don't feel like a threat. They feel like a good team. If you're playing against them, if you're coaching against them, they'd get your attention. They would demand your respect. But when you're talking about who could win a Stanley Cup, I'm not putting them in the conversation.
No, they're really not. And I guess when I look at them, I always think about, who's your superstars? Where's your superstars? Because all the teams that win Stanley Cups, mm-hmm. they have superstars. They have those elite players either in goal, on defense, or on the forward line. And I love the Minnesota Wild, and you said it right. I mean, this is a very competitive team that works hard and makes the playoffs. Sometimes they win a round, sometimes they don't. But they don't have that elite player or players that you need to get a little bit further along in the Stanley Cup line. And so you're right. I mean, they're not in my – you wouldn't put them in the top 8 to win a Stanley Cup. You would put them in the top 12 to get into the playoffs, but you wouldn't put them in the top 8 to win a cup.
And it's tough to win in the playoffs when you look across, and if you're being impartial and you look at the other team's roster and my roster doesn't have any one of the 3 or 4 best players in the series. And I think that's where Minnesota ends up in these playoff series, going up against Nashville, going up against Winnipeg, having gone up against Chicago. The other teams had the best players, 2 or 3 or 4 of them, before you got to Minnesota's very, very good players.
Right.
It's just hard to win that way.
All right.
Now, a lot of organizations would love their regular season success.
Absolutely.
They've been really, really good. And it's no slight on not being able to win a Stanley Cup. It's very difficult. Talk to Washington. Mm-hmm. They were great for a decade plus. They never got it done. Minnesota's had a great run of success. Just not as much as they're hoping for.
What's the biggest reason why this team is seeing so much success right now?
Well, number one is defense. There's no doubt about it. Talk about players buying into a particular system. And Barry Trotz, with his Stanley Cup in his back pocket, has been able to come in and been able to sell everybody his bag of goods. And one of the players that's kind of a little bit of an unsung hero for these New York Islanders is Casey Cizikas. And really, from my mind, he's the identity of the team if you follow this around here. This guy plays such a good two-way game. No, he's not a superstar. He's not going to score 40 or 50 goals. But look at his position. He looked to check to see it was a 3-on-3. He gets a quick up. He's back in his own defensive zone. He knows when there's support, so he knows when to 2-on-1 and the offensive player. So his positioning is good. He makes simple plays all the time using his defense player partner as an out. And he just, he's been so consistent. He loses the puck. What would most guys do in this situation? They would probably just skate and turn away. No, he stops two or three quick strides and gets back into the play and then takes the puck away again from the opposition. I mean, this has been the type of player he is, and he's been able to get his line mates to play the same way. He's got this physical presence. He's not 6 foot nine. Knocked Scheifele over, who's a big, strong guy for the Winnipeg Jets. So he brings this physical element to his game. He's also a very good offensive player. He's having his career best season with scoring 9 goals. So he's the identity. Yes, Barzal's a great individual player. There's no doubt about it. But it's all about Cizikas and his fourth line.
When you guys look back at Team USA and what they accomplished in this tournament, what do you take away from the World Juniors this year and then maybe the steps and the progression that the Red, White, and Blue did do?
I felt like it was a very close tournament. You know, like there were about 4 or 5 countries that really could have won gold and could have missed the medal. And I thought the Americans really rose to the occasion. When they needed a good game, when they had a tough opponent, they seemed to play better. And it seemed like they even had more in them. They were still growing as the tournament went on. Felt like if there was another week, if there was another 3-4 games, they would have been in even better shape because they were just seemingly getting better every day, which is a testament to the coaches and the kind of talent they have. And they were right there, 90 seconds away in winning this tournament. So they were excellent throughout.
And with any tournament, and especially when you have the parity, and you're absolutely right. I mean, there's certainly five or six teams that could have won the gold medal. And really what it comes down to in my mind is, do you get the save at the right time, and do you get to score a goal at the right time? And that was really the difference. If you look at the quarterfinals, the semifinals, and the final, at the end of the day, that's really pretty much what it was, is the ability to score or the ability to prevent a goal. So it's just a great tournament. I mean, it's just got to be so much fun for these guys to play for their country, to meet so many different hockey players that they don't know, come together, experience a very unique situation. Doesn't happen maybe twice in your lifetime as a junior hockey player. And the opportunity to win a medal in this kind of a tournament, I mean, again, you only get one or two times, and that's it. So it's got to be unbelievable.
I liked your question to Coach Hastings, because it was coach via coach there. Mm-hmm. Have you ever coached in a tournament quite like this, where you gotta get through to your players in such a quick amount of time and get that chemistry to really gel together? Otherwise, you're going to be packing pretty quickly.
No, I was never involved in taking over a team with just, like, say, 10 games to go, where you gotta rally them. And so that's a very unique experience. But it does take a lot of communication, just in listening to guys that have been through and being around hockey long enough to understand, you know, what's needed. And he's exactly right. I mean, it's the coaching staff, and you got to lean on the guys that are your guns and that have experience with the scenario. And obviously they did a tremendous job. But again, it's going to be. I mean, when I was watching those games, it was just like, it's just so exciting, because you know there's, especially when you get to one and you're done.
Yeah.
Then that's just like playing game 7.
Yeah. And I think you mentioned a couple times there, going with the guys who have experience. I think you also see the advantage in having some returnees.
Building a team.
If you can have 5 or 6 or 7 or 8, yeah, the more returnees you have. Look at, you know, Switzerland had a whole bunch coming this year versus last year, where they got bombed out of the tournament. They had more guys this year. Even though they're young men, having one time gone that's through right. it already really does have advantages the next time. You're more prepared to understand what you're getting yourself into.
Finland, 5.5 million people, and I heard this question a little bit earlier today. When you think of the top four powerhouses in international hockey, mm-hmm, especially at the World Junior level or any level, let's just go international hockey, who's in your top four? USA?
Well, USA and Canada. 1-2.
Okay.
I think Sweden is a pretty solid 3.
Yes.
And then,
would Russia have been in there? And now the question is Finland?
Well, look at the results. 3 goals in the last 6 seasons.
I know.
At the World Junior level, and that is a precursor to the stars heading to the NHL. So if they're trending the right direction, it would be Finland, because
look,
they have
the names,
all these
too,
young stars in the past 5-6 years coming into the NHL that are not just players in the NHL, not just good in the NHL, but superstars in the making, and they have more coming with another gold medal team. So the very fact that we're even having this conversation, Russia with the hundreds of millions of people and the history of hockey in that country is kind of neck and neck with Finland, is amazing what they're doing with their developmental program.
I think it's just an unbelievable story, really. I've been talking about really over the last couple of months is just how good these Finnish players are in the National Hockey League, and it started about 5-6 years ago where you got these great players and they're not just surviving, they're becoming all-stars, they're becoming elite hockey players, and a little wonder that they're winning junior tournaments, because the players that were on that team are coming in and they're being pretty good in the National Hockey League. So whatever they're doing or whatever they're eating in Finland, we got to get
send it our way.
We got to get the recipe, because I mean, 3 in the last 6 years, nobody else has done that. So they're doing a lot of things right.
Yeah, and that's just some of the names. Kind of Rask and Pekka Rinne on that list.
They're a little bit older for sure, but the snowball starts rolling down the hill now, because now the expectations are higher.
Right.
All the young athletes who are great young athletes in Finland will be drawn to the most popular sport, which might become Finland. And then it gets that much easier to keep developing these high-end players.
All right.
Amazing.
We'll,
and then they'll be favored to win the junior tournament. And now you got to deal with that.
A whole another bit of pressure on that one.
Mike Hastings, head coach of Team USA, nice enough to join us on the phone right now. Coach, Happy New Year, and congratulations on making the Americans proud and what you did in that tournament. Nothing to hang your head about in that one. Of course, maybe disappointing and not the kind of finish that you guys were hoping for as far as your expectations going in. But now that you've had a day or two to kind of think about the tournament as a whole, what would you tell your team, and what did you tell your team immediately following that gold medal game?
Well, first of all, I want to say thanks for having me on and the opportunity. And with that, one of the first things I addressed them about was that, we might be disappointed in how that night went and not finishing and winning a gold medal, but not disappointed in the progress we had in the tournament. And we had some big shoes to fill going into the tournament with USA Hockey winning 3 consecutive medals over the 3 years, and we didn't want to let those people down. And I thought the guys showed themselves very well throughout the tournament, and we got better as the tournament went on, and very proud of what they accomplished.
Mike, you're absolutely right. A lot to be proud of in a tournament involving a lot of teenagers. You never know what you're going to get, but your team gave a pretty good performance virtually every night. So much attention on you guys. So much attention on anyone with the last name of Hughes on your team. So maybe talk about managing the brothers, both Quinn and Jack, and how they performed for you in the tournament.
Well, hey, there wasn't a lot of management with those two, just because when you have two young men that are that talented, that are team first guys, put the progress of our group ahead of everything else. And I'll first talk about Quinn. After we had played not a great first 50 minutes against Sweden, we had a little get together soon after that game and discussed what we needed to do better. Went to the 5 guys that were returners, which Quinn was one of them, and Quinn stepped up and said, hey, I've got to be better. I've got to make some better puck decisions and do those things. So he stepped up as a leader. And then Jack, went through some injury issues and wanted to play even sooner than when he did. So when you have two guys like that put the team in front of their own aspirations, it's real easy as a coaching staff to support them. And I think the players supported them also.
Mike, whenever you have to get a bunch of new kids together that haven't played a season long or even 2 season long, it must be a very challenging event. Could you talk a little bit about what you went through to get these guys on the same page?
Yeah, 2 things. First of all, I'd say the staff that I was surrounded by, Scott Sandel and Steve Miller, Jerry Keefe and David Lassonde did a great job at unifying our message to the group. And then the 5 guys that were returning, we laid a lot on their shoulders immediately and asked them to be leaders by example, and then also taking our message as a coaching staff and asking them to live it and own it. And they did a fantastic job of that. You look at Ryan Poehling's performance in the tournament, Dylan Sandberg, Mikey Anderson, we've already talked about Quinn, and then Josh Norris. They paved the way for that young group to come in, guys that had not been through the tournament before, and they did a great job of delivering that message.
Coach, I want to ask you about Finland and what a gold medal game it was. But in the end, it was the Finns. And what is it about this country that, compared to USA or Canada or Russia, population size, this is a country of 5.5 million people, yet they continue to churn out the superstars in the NHL. Can you put your finger on what makes this country so good, maybe starting from a grassroots level?
Well, you know, I can only go by sharing with what I've talked to some people at USA Hockey about, and trying to do the same thing within our country to continue to develop high-end players. And they've just shared, gone over, done homework, worked together with Finland on trying to look at different ways to develop those skills at a much earlier level than maybe even the national program in Plymouth. And they've done it at the grassroots level. And I think they're working together on trying to make sure that they're doing that. And you've got to tip your hat to Finland. They earned the gold medal, and it was something that we were definitely after, trying to capture ourselves. But they got a bounce and made a play at the end of a game, and we didn't. And so I just think Finland's doing things the right way. But I have to say I'm very proud of what USA Hockey's doing, because they're trying to do it the right way also.
As he should be, Mike, for sure. And it looked like it was going to take a pretty special effort to beat Caden Primo in net. We saw lots of clips of Keith up there in the stands looking very nervous. You guys didn't really have a number one goalie going in. What was it about Caden Primo's game that made you believe that he was the guy for you beyond the gaudy numbers that he was putting up?
His demeanor, both on the rink and off the rink. Very, very calm. He almost settled our bench at times. When we were playing Russia, you saw him, I think, step to the forefront more than anybody else and say, you know what, we're going to go compete for a gold medal here. And he just, early in the tournament, he had a little trouble around his net, and Dave Lassonde, our goaltending coach, did a great job at cleaning that up. And from that point on, I thought he took the ball and wasn't going to give it up again.
Mike, obviously it was a great tournament with some great teams, but what do you take away from the entire tournament that might serve you better in the future?
Well, you know what, I met with the leadership group of my own team when I got back to talk about just a few of those things. And one of them, what a team can accomplish when you have everybody buying in and being selfless and doing the things that really what our identity was as we went through that tournament. And it grew to a point of, if we could get everybody on the same page and understand what makes us good, you can have an opportunity to be there playing and having an opportunity to win your last game. That's one. Two, I stole some things from the guys that I was around, fortunate enough to be around as far as coaching staff. So I think there's some little nuances that I'm going to take to our program and try and help make ourselves better as a group. And then the third thing is just the pride from the idea of what it is to be part of USA Hockey and make sure that we're always putting our best foot forward as far as efforts as coaches and what those players actually go through in that tournament and anything that we can do to help progress that at a grassroots level, whether it's where we're at here, whether you get to a tournament like that, we've got to step up as coaches and do that. So those are three things that I'd say that I take away from the tournament. It was a phenomenal experience.
Well, we appreciate your time, Coach, and you and your players should be very proud of what you accomplished up there in Victoria as well as Vancouver. It was certainly proud to watch you guys do what you did up there. So congratulations on that, and best of luck, Coach, and going forward, okay?
Thanks for having me on, guys. Take care.
If you're going to debut like Jordan Binnington did, that's the way you want to do it, with a Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout. Scotty, what a start for him.
Yeah, he had some big saves. He played well, but the team was good in front of him. And it's funny how teams get up when they have a young goaltender in net, especially his first game, and you see Binnington here playing very well. But the team played pretty well in front of him also, the Blues did. And it's just a nice start for Binnington. You see him making a big save there, a nice tight shot there, nice and square. Nice little save on Giroux. So he was square to the shooters, and he had lots of help from the Blues. They had good sticks. They cleaned up the secondary rebounds, so he didn't have to make the second saves. He was able to make the first save, and their D were there to clear the rebounds.
A fine first impression. This is nothing new for him this season, though. He leads the AHL in goals against average at 2.08. Help us understand the role there, because as you point out, it's not just him between the cage. It's the D helping him and he's helping the D. It's a nice partnership.
Absolutely. If there's, like I said, there was no second shot. So D were boxing out. They're clearing rebounds, letting them see the first shot. The Flyers had some testing chances, but overall, I thought it was a good team effort. And I always find when it's a goalie's first game, the team seems to be a little more detailed in their defensive game. And I think we saw that. You get five guys back to the house. They want to help the young kid out, and they did that tonight. Binnington was excellent, but I thought the team played very well in front of him.
And it was a point you made as we were watching that game unfold, because the Flyers, where they were so good at shot suppression when Carter Hart first came up, not as good at that now. Sugar, shout out Pekka Rinne and the Preds. It's impressive what Pekka did. You take away that Austin Matthews goal, which was wiped off, Scotty, but you were especially impressed by shot suppression. A total of 18 shots for the whole game for Toronto.
Yeah, the Nashville team did a good job taking away any secondary chances. Pekka Rinne was great on the first shot. Nothing was getting by him. And when they did get by him, they hit the post, or it was the offside goal Matthews scored that was called back. But Pekka Rinne's been unbelievable. Saros has been good for this team. They're getting their D healthy, and what a defense they have.
The reigning Vezina Trophy winner, his third shutout of the season. It's Marc-Andre Fleury at the top of that statistical category. Even with that goal taken away, Austin Matthews with 20 on the season. Let me rattle off the names of every Toronto Maple Leaf to ever start their career with three straight seasons of 20 goals or more. Austin Matthews. And that's it. Very impressive. But that's not the story tonight. The story is these Preds, as you point out, getting healthy. And all of a sudden, boy, do they look impressive. I know you're high on Forsberg.
Absolutely.
What about the D? You saw something specific at the blue line from Ryan Ellis.
Well, they like to shut down the rush early. And if you're not ready for it, the D like to stand up. They like to stand up on their PK. And you'll see Ellis right here. Look at standing up, not backing up, standing up on Tavares. The puck's turned over. Yarncroak gets it. And then they play the north-south game. They just go north here. Guys go to the net. See Sissons goes to the net. Pucks gets behind the defenseman. No one picks up Sissons. He puts a puck in behind Hutchinson. This is how they play on the PK. This is how they play regular strength. They want to shut down rushes before they get going, especially against a good Leafs team who can score and transition on the rush. But here it is right here. You want to make that pass. That puck should have went deep. Turned over, Ryan Ellis, just a little chip back, and here they go off to the races. Like I said, Yarncroak, and now they have coverage. No one just picks up Sissons right there. Johansson doesn't take his guy to the net, and there it is. Sissons puts it in the net. So you got to manage the puck through the neutral zone when you're playing the Nashville Predators, because their D love to stand up, and then they transition and get you on the odd man rushes.
Matthias Ekholm, 1-on-1. We talk about their back end, and understandably so, P.K. Subban gets a lot of credit, and Ryan Ellis, and we understand Roman Josi, the captain. Matthias Ekholm is underrated and underappreciated, despite the fact that hockey people talk about him all the time. Why?
Well, another late draft pick, and they just develop defensemen in Nashville. I mean, it's a farm system for defensemen. He gets up and down the ice. He's a big body. He shoots a puck. He's just developed into an all-around player. He can play 5-on-5, PK, power play. We saw the big shot, but he carries the puck, and he's a big, rangy guy, has a great stick, defends well. This is one of the best defense in the National Hockey League. And they are solid and deep. And getting Subban back, we saw him score with a big shot. They can all shoot the puck from the point. They're very dangerous. The Nashville Predators love to use their defense when they go low to high very well. And then they know the puck's going to get there. And they go to the net and get rebounds and tips. So it all starts from the defense with this offense in Nashville.
A feel-good night for Nashville. PK's parents were in the stands, able to watch what his team did. What an impressive win for them. Now to the final seconds. Extra attacker on. Dubnyk and the Wild salt this one away. 3 seconds, the face-off, and time runs out on the Habs. It's a Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout. Devin Dubnyk and the Wild. A lot of people were worried about this club, but they are going on a surge. You believe in them, why?
I love their special teams. I think they've added a few nice pieces. I like Eric Fair. I like Greg Pattern, number 29. We see her on defense. I think they've gotten stronger. And I think they're playing pretty good hockey. They went through a bit of a lull where I thought they were playing well, doing a lot of good things. They just weren't scoring goals. And right now they're back playing really good hockey, and the tides have turned for the Minnesota Wild. Dubnyk's playing great hockey with another shutout here. And they started this road trip 3-0. They're off to a great start, and it's always fun to win on the road and get a big shutout in Montreal. There's no better place to get a shutout than in Montreal.
The Bell Center, impressive indeed. His first shutout of the season. You see what he's done since he got to the Wild. Stone, the Hall of Fame defenseman, Scott Stevens said, this player is the hottest player on the planet. I don't want to argue with you, and there's no sense in doing it. When you look at the numbers at the reigning first star of the week, Johnny Hockey is putting up. Gaudreau with 2 more goals in this one. He's got goals every game, it seems.
Yeah, it's amazing. He's more of a playmaker, but this year he's putting the puck in the net as much as he is setting up other players on his team, and this is great news. But just a nice play here by Giordano off the backboards and breakaway for Goudreau.
Help us understand why, as a playmaker, when you're a D and you're looking at his numbers, you want a guy that's got a disparity, either a lot of goals and a few assists or vice versa. When he's equally balanced in those things, why is it tough?
I don't want him to be predictable. A lot of guys, you know, they're going to hold the puck. They're looking to make a pass every time. They're not going to shoot the puck. I know how to play that guy. I can cheat on him a bit. But when Goudreau is scoring goals at the same rate as he's setting up goals, it makes him hard to defend. He's unpredictable. You can't pattern him. And I like his game. It's getting better. He's scoring goals. He's learning how to score goals in this league, which is going to make him a better hockey player. And he's already a phenomenal hockey player.
Pick 103 in the draft. And we always focus on his size. But the great author, Canadian like you, Malcolm Gladwell, says there is an advantage to disadvantage. He's been small his whole life. He played in all those three-on-three leagues growing up. He knows how to find, and I'm borrowing this from you, the space.
Yes.
He's great at finding that. You compared it to Gretzky at one point.
And this is a guy you got to take his time and space away, because the more time he has to make a play, the better play he's going to make, whether he scores a goal or sets up a goal. And too often, teams give him too much respect. But why not? When you're as hot as Johnny Hockey is, people are backing up and giving him a lot of respect, and he's taking advantage of that right now. But he's seeing the ice, and he's just fun to watch. And we always said this, he's worth the money to watch play hockey. And right now, this is the best hockey he's ever played, I think, in his career.
That's great. And the Flames are continuing to set the pace in the Pacific Division. We're going to take a break. When we come back, Scotty's all fired up that Philip Forsberg is back. He'll help us understand just what he brings for the Preds. They're getting healthy, and they had a statement win tonight. More on that right after this.
Bridgestone tires are built to come through in the clutch, just like NHL players.
Presented by Navy Federal Credit Union.
As we honor our great nation and the men and women serving our country at home and overseas, we ask that you please rise and remove your hats.
Staff Sergeant Jeffrey Neelang has been in the Air Force for 7 years as an explosive ordnance disposal team leader.
And welcome a very special guest, Major Chris O'Melia of the United States Marine Corps.
Today at the Winter Classic,
please rise as colors are presented by the University of Notre Dame's Air Force, Army, and Navy ROTC units.
Hero of the game, Sergeant Major Christina E. Hunt's Horse May of the United States Marine Corps. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For your service.
And dedication to our country.
Thank you indeed. And thank you to the Sharks and the Kings for an entertaining first period. An exciting first 20. Sharks up. We'll tell you how they got there right after this.
Time now for an all-goalie edition of Three Stars. Weeksy would love this. Third star is Pekka Rinne, who made 18 saves to blank the Leafs in Toronto. Rinne now has 3 shutouts on the season with a .921 save percentage. The second star of Monday is Jordan Binnington, who made the most of his first NHL start by turning in a 25-save shutout in Philly. The 25-year-old becomes just the second goalie in Blues history to pitch a shutout in his first career start. And your first star of the night goes to Devan Dubnyk, who was one stop better than Carey Price in his 32-save shutout at Bell Center. With the shutout, Dubnyk now has a .937 save percentage in his last 5 starts.
5 games on the dock tonight.
The last time Dennis Hall had a pair of skates on was 1993.
These are the moments you wait for. I know that he's very well prepared for this moment.
How did that go in? Patrick Kane.
I think his mom and dad's seats are very close to that area.
Johnny can roll right in. Stop it. Scores. Sneaks one through.
Sissons in front. They score.
A little cherry on top.
Randall loose off front. He scores!
Kane wide open, they score the rebound! Jonas Danskoy left alone.
How about that? A shutout in his first start in the NHL for Jordan Binnington. What a start!
Granlund, Zucker, and Koivu. Koivu shot, save, Price. Greenway stopped on the rebound. It's still loose. Niederreiter sprawls. And Price with another big save.
Carey Price
a few just miraculous saves there.
Tarasenko makes a nice move on Haig and cuts toward the middle. A shot, save, and rebound. It did not go as Hart slid across.
I thought that went in. Wow.
On the wing, Ekholm. Back for Smith. Sissons. In front, they score. Kevin Fiala. Little cherry on top.
Look out, what a right skate save out at deflection in front.
Oh, what a reaction, that one.
Kane. Scored! He scored! Patrick Kane. Well, when you're hot, you're hot. That's seven goals in the last five.